Hello and welcome to the hard sell, where the stick in the swill bucket rattles back. I think I've arrived late. By about 35 years. Oh well. So on the 10th of February this year, Hugh Hudson died at the age of 86. Which came as a shock to me. Not his death, so much as the realisation that that generation of British directors were that old. The ones who got their start in British advertising in the 1970s, then moved on to film careers that revitalised Hollywood, and got them so famous they occasionally came back to commercials, only this time with massive budgets. The likes of Ridley and Tony Scott, Alan Parker, Adrian Lyne, Stephen Frears, and Paul Weiland in an alternate universe where Leonard Part 6 didn't end his career before it began, possibly because there Bill Cosby went to prison early and actually stayed there. Most of those worked at the same company, Ridley Scott Associates, Hugh Hudson included. He started out in documentaries, initially as an editor, and then as one-third of the production company Hudson Ground Drum Camel. One of his first directorial credits was on The Tortoise and the Hare, an experimental short art vittorial piece for Corelli about a truck and a sports car driving through Naples. The kind of thing that could only have been made in 1966. Tortoise and Hare was BAFTA nominated, and indeed the works of Hudson Brown John Camel, while barely noticed by the general public, were highly influential within the industry itself, with their playful, editing-heavy approach to non-fiction filmmaking. They were particularly influential on the advertising industry, who saw in them freedom for merely having grey people describing their products down the lens.
The tasty way to help you stay trim.
I'm not saying Hugh Hudson and Company invented being interesting and creative, but they did help popularise it. So the obvious thing for Hudson to do after that is to actually go into advertising, signing up with Ridley Scott Associates, where he worked with Alan Parker until Hollywood dragged him away. Hudson's breakthrough, of course, was the hallucinatory Benson and Hedges cinema ad with the swimming pool in the desert. This has come up on multiple occasions, so I won't go over it too much here, but I would point out how it sort of anticipates or even announces the sense of hyper-reality that would come to dominate what's become known as the golden age of advertising. Follow-up, perhaps even more so. The desert one at least had something resembling recognisable context, a romanticised sketch of how one of the billboard images was made. The alternative, an almost literal photo negative, is more like a puzzling nightmare. Both also demonstrate Hudson's mastery of montage, editing and composition, which enhanced even highly straightforward adverts like this one for Dubonnet.
Je Dubonne. Il Dubonne. Elle Dubonne. Nous Dubonnons. du bon. Du bon et vous?
Nothing special in form, perhaps, just a montage of beautiful people and a laboured joke about French conjugation. But never underestimate a good craftsman. Every shot is carefully blocked, timed and angled to look as perfect as possible, with symmetries and colour contrasts always ensuring you're looking at the element the advert wants you to be looking at. Similarly, the famous handbuilt by robots advert for the Fiat Strada. You know the one. This is less cinema verite than it looks. You think Fiat just let Hudson and his company wander into a factory and shoot? Pause for half an hour at every cut and you're closer to the mark. It was very annoying for all concerned. But it resulted in a lyrical ballet, yes I know it's an opera on the soundtrack, a figurative ballet of metal and chrome, that helped relaunch Fiat to a decade of success before recession and corruption caught up with them in the early 90s. Driven by Italians. Fiat weren't the only brand Hudson helped revitalise. Courage Brewers, best known for their best bitter, were in a bit of a slump in the late 70s, to the extent that they were actively trying to mine people's nostalgia for the damn stuff, with an advert in black and white depicting a romanticised version of interbellum London, soundtracked by then largely unknown Cockney pub rockers Chaz and Dave. The campaign ran to the end of the 80s, but it's the Hudson-directed launch ad that really matters. That's the one everyone remembers. All the others were basically increasingly shallow imitations. Again, Hudson's talent for composition was a major contributor to the ad's success. It's shot in a single take, initially as a frozen tableau. The real secret weapon, though, was the cinematographer. Hudson and Company had decided they didn't just want it set in the 30s, they wanted it to look like it was made then as well. So they tracked down the retired Australian lensman Robert Krasker, then something of a forgotten legend, but now remembered as one of the greatest cinematographers in film history, not to be called Conrad Hall. This is the man who shot Odd Man Out, Brief Encounter and The Friggin' Third Man. They had a day to film this, and reportedly practically the whole thing was spent by Krasker on arranging the tableau and getting the lighting right. The results speak for themselves. Body glossy with a little piece of ice. Anything that comes with lemon in a slice. Fancy cocktails that are shaken and not stirred. Drinks with cherries in that make you look absurd. With your finger cocked to leave your friends impressed. Anything that ain't a pint of courage best. Mine's a pint of best. Mine's a pint. Remember, a pint of best. Courage do. Kraska died shortly afterwards, which is one of the reasons later adverts in the series are nowhere near as good. Not having Hugh Hudson was another. Because like most of the Scott Associates alumni, Hudson eventually graduated shortly after the Courage Best campaign to feature filmmaking, becoming part of that brief, dizzying period when the most interesting films coming out of Hollywood were being made by British people. We all know what his first, best and most famous film was, and indeed My Chariot's on Fire launched him almost immediately into the front rank of filmmakers. It wasn't the end of his advertising career, but the commercials did understandably slow down at this point. Chariot was followed up by the decent but awkward Greystoke, his first actual Hollywood film, a realistic take on Tarzan so poker-faced that the word Tarzan never appears in the script. It was also a box office success. And then Hudson's third film was Revolution, which was a disaster on a scale so vast and so fundamental you may not even have heard of it. It's not even a legendary fiasco like Heaven's Gate or Battlefield Earth, at least not outside of cinema geeks. It was just a massive failure all around for a huge number of reasons, mostly but not exclusively out of Hugh Hudson's control. I mean, it was his idea to cast Al Pacino as a grizzled Scots trapper, after all, and Natasha Kinski as a rebellious aristocrat. But it wasn't his idea to release the film to theatres before it was actually finished. That stroke of genius came from the producer's gold crest. Their reward for doing so was oblivion, as the black hole that Revolution became not only destroyed them, it crippled the entire British film industry. Damn near destroyed Al Pacino, he didn't make another film for 5 years, and basically brought Hugh Hudson's career as a serious filmmaker to a screeching halt. He never stopped making movies, although he didn't make very many more, but he was never allowed near a major project or a decent budget again. For what it's worth, he eventually went back and re-edited Revolution with new narration from Pacino and a story that isn't just a bunch of events thrown together at random. It's actually 10 minutes shorter. Now, apparently this version is pretty good, if still not great. It does still have Pacino's trying to sound vaguely British, for one thing.
All these men here, we all fought for something. You take it from us, and we're going to fight again.
So, having been chewed up and spat out by the movie industry, Hudson returned for a living to commercials. But things were different now. Before Chariots of Fire, he was just another advert director, albeit one of the better and more expensive ones around. Now, he was the Oscar-nominated director of an Oscar-winning Best Picture. Revolution notwithstanding, he was a big name. So he got jobs like this.
This is the night mail crossing the border, bringing the check and the postal order. Letters for the rich, letters for the poor, the shop at the corner and the girl next door. Pulling up Betok a steady climb, the gradient's against her, but she is on time.
You might remember this epic train propaganda from the Trains episode. I say epic, I mean 2 minutes long, which is practically David Lean standards for an advert.
Passing the shunter, intent on its toil, moving the coke and the coal and the oil, girders for bridges, plastic for fridges, bricks for the site are required by tonight. Grimy and grey's the engine's reflection, down to the docks for the metal collection.
Harking back to his old job as a visual documentarian, as well as harking back to one of the most famous British documentaries, this is British Rail attempting to relaunch themselves one last time after finally realising that we're getting there actually implied that they were crap. Privatisation looming, this is their "you're gonna miss us" message. And again, it brings Hudson's mastery of montage and composition to the fore, but on a much larger scale than that DuBonnet thing.
The passenger train is full of commuters bound for the office to work in computers. The teacher, the doctor, the actor in farce, the typist, the banker, the judge in first class, reading the Times with a crossword to do, returning at night on the 6:42.
Epic, of course, is very much what Hudson was associated with by now, with the vast scales and landscapes of Chariots and Greystoke. Even Revolution was good-looking, if incoherent and miscast. All of which made him perfect for Britain's Railway, and even more so for perhaps his most famous and certainly most seen work. You know the one. That's why I'm dressed like a Burke. Such and Such had held the British Airways contract since the company's privatisation. It was the theme of the 80s. And their tenure had already included some amazing imagery. Like the journey to Mars, Manhattan in flight. This one, as made by Hudson, topped the lot. No special visual effects or compositing, just flat empty Utah, some swimmers, a whole lot of school kids, and a choreographer with a megaphone.
World's favorite airline brings 24 million people together.
Oh, and Malcolm McLaren, Yanni and Leo Delibes on the soundtrack. Because Malcolm was going through this whole switched-on bark phase at the time. But it's notable that the original flower duet itself became British Airways' unofficial theme after this, and not this Yannified version of it in particular. The face advert, although its official title is Globe, missing its own point completely, became almost instantaneously iconic, running for over half a decade with only occasional changes. They had to update the BA uniforms at one point, and there were some completely pointless variations for special occasions, like this one with a big football for the 1994 World Cup.
British Airways, the world's favourite airline.
Or this Christmas one with added sleigh bells and Kringle and pudding.
Every year, favorite airline brings 24 million people together.
Not happy, you know.
The main problem with something like this is in following it up. BA and the Saatchis, or rather their company, because the actual Saatchi brothers have been fired by now, kept their faith with the same crew, including Hugh Hudson, with a stunt that's arguably even more impressive in practical terms.
Airways. We cover the world.
Even Christo and Jean-Claude only wrapped the coastlines, not the entire friggin' island. You probably don't remember this one though, as it didn't catch on in the same way. The concept is a little obscure, more static, and naturally less human. There's that middle bit, like in the face advert, that's meant to be showing people coming together. It doesn't work quite so well here, because with the face, people coming together was the whole point. It was the slogan. Here, the slogan is a more oblique pun about covering the world. So including this whole bit just feels like flat imitation of the earlier version. Still good, though. Naturally, there are plenty of parodies of the face, I mean, not the island. And I want to call your attention in particular to the Hot Point one from 1993 or so, because it's such a good and thorough impression, right down to the noise at the end.
Britain's favourite washing machines wash the socks, shirts and undies of over 6 million homes. And now, Hot Point's new Aquarius Ultra range gives our best performance ever.
The most notable of all is probably this one. Silverjet was an achingly exclusive airline that ran solely in business class. Its launch, and pretty much sole advert, was all about that exclusivity. And to be fair to them, they came up with a brilliant way to express it. Take a famous advert from the same sector and rejig it to suit their own message. Better yet, they actually hired as many of the same crew as they possibly could, including Hugh Hudson himself, making it a self-parody. All to put forward a kind of depressing message, really. Only a few people can use this airline, and you never will. Because you're not good enough and you never will be.
Every day, Silverjet brings a select few people together.
Eat it, Prolls. We are your superiors. Unsurprisingly, the whole venture only lasted 2 years. That slogan probably didn't help, mind. It's barely even a pun. Of course, certain shots from this do play differently post-COVID. Hudson never stopped working. His last film as director was Finding Outer Mirror from 6 years ago. And the last film he ever worked on came out just last year, The Tiger's Nest, which he co-wrote. He made at least one of the great British films, and could have made more with a bit more luck and a better script, and more sympathetic producers, and smarter casting. What if Revolution had just plain never happened, basically? But it did. And frankly, even so, he didn't owe us anything. He gave us some of the most enduring pop cultural images of the last 45 years or so. An iguana watching a giant cigarette box being flown through the desert. A winking face made of people. A bunch of robots elegantly putting together a car to some classic opera. Oh, and some running men as well.
People who are forming the face, not to me.
You just sat through a Bob the Fish production. Nice! If you haven't already, you absolutely must check out bobthefish.org.uk. Literally hundreds more videos, not unlike that one, adding up to days worth of entertainment and all absolutely free. But if you're not a cold-hearted skinflint, you can always support us on Patreon. For as little as anything at all, you can make programs like the one you just watched possible in the first place, and become eligible for bonus material such as glimpses of the book I'm writing about the BBC, monthly riffings on random commercial breaks, the complete archives of the angry political satire magazine Two Sons, and even the odd very occasional bonus video essay unavailable anywhere else. If nothing else, you should prevent me from starving and or freezing to death in the foreseeable future, so that'd be nice. No pressure or anything. Well, UK, you make it what it is.